Thank you. I think that was a very nice introduction to the next hour. So that's from the record Desiderium.
Yes.
That you just put out.
Sorry. Yes, it is.
I wondered, I mean, we're going to do a little bit of showing the kind of behind the sort of under the hood shortly. But I thought before we start seeing kind of actually how you made some of that, perhaps could you tell us what the starting point was for that record?
For the record I just played, I mean, I can't really remember at this point. I think I started off with the percussion. And if you listen to the beginning, there is this sort of East Asian sort of percussive sample. And from there, I started to build, I guess, chords around that. And yeah, it just kind of built itself. Most of the songs I make are like that. They just sort of build upon themselves without any specific direction.
And then if you kind of take it out wider, what was the starting point for the whole piece, the whole album?
I guess all my albums are sort of collections of certain periods of my life. And there was no specific, you know, I'm going to make an album and I want all these songs to sound like this and I'm going to go and make tracks towards this one goal. I decided to make the album after I had made a bunch of tracks, and all these songs sort of reflected that point in my life where, you know, I chose to do certain things stylistically at that point, and I learned certain tricks that I wanted to express in those songs. And from there, I just picked out the ones I really liked and turned it into an album.
So it was more like the album kind of came into being because you had a bunch of songs that suddenly felt like they could be the beginning of a collection.
Exactly.
Is that a different way of working for you? Like with the other records that you've done, were they more like the result of a conscious decision, oh, I want to make an album and here's some time and I'm going to make some tracks? Is that a different way of doing it?
Not really. All of my albums are basically, were put together the same way. I had made a collection of songs and decided I think I'm ready to, you know, put these together into an album. Obviously, I've made more tracks than just what ended up on this album, but I decided that these represented the best of what I did during this time, and I just really wanted people to hear them. And I think that putting out a collection of music versus one song represents more. You know, you can explain a fuller story, sort of like an anthology. You have all these little stories within one big book.
Another thing that's kind of different on this record is you and your voice as an instrument is more present on it. Did you have to do any kind of finding of your voice, or did you always know kind of how you sound?
I don't sound very good, I'll say that. I can't sing. But then as a producer, I've always enjoyed working with vocalists, and when I'm making a track and I feel like I want to have a female vocal on it at that time, I'm a female vocal. It's really easy for me to decide to do that. And
you're not going to be late.
Exactly. And I know how to sort of accomplish what I want for the track, since it's me working for me, if that makes sense. But I'm very honest. I can't sing. I sing really, really, really bad. Okay. I'm not the worst singer. We can go to karaoke together and, you know, I can hold my own, but you know, compared to some of the vocalists I choose to work with, I'm not as adequate as them to some extent. But then as a producer, and the way that I decide to work with my vocals in the tracks, you know, there are tools such as Melodyne and Auto-Tune. And I tend to pitch my vocals to achieve a goal. So I want to treat my vocals more like an instrument than a focus.
I wonder if it might be worth giving us a little bit of show and tell on something to do with what like maybe an interesting way or a trick you used or something. I'm not saying like give away all your secrets, but perhaps is there an example of a way that you used your voice in kind of an interesting way or a way that pleased you?
Show a track? Yeah. Okay, let's see. This is a lot of pressure.
You're among friends.
I'll play something older. Here's a good example. Thank you. For example, with a track like that, the voice doesn't sound too manipulated, but it is. I double the voice, and a lot of the harmonies on here are made from pitching in Ableton. I should show a better example. So, let's see. I mean, a trick I like to use a lot is just making the pitch vocals sound artificial on purpose. You know, obviously in Ableton, you have the ability to do, or for those of you who do use Ableton and are aware, you can warp and pitch anything and make it sound fairly accurate. I tend to like to work with it in a way where I purposely make it sound stretched or chopped up. So the vocal sounds inauthentic, but on purpose. With the track that I just showed you as an example, where I'm trying to make it sound a little bit more accurate, but towards the end, I start layering harmonies on top of each other. Let's see if I can find it. So here you'll be able to hear the vocals sounding a bit more fake, you know, just pitched up. So with I don't know if it's that easy for you guys to hear, but like the high vocals and low vocals are completely pitched, as well as, I mean, when the chorus comes back in again, there's even more vocals that end up creating a texture, and that's how I like to use my vocals in music. I don't really want you to focus on the singing ability more so than just how much the vocals create almost like a pad, and make the song sound thicker and create an environment. So I don't know if I just digressed, but there we go.
Not at all, not at all. I think that's exactly, well, that's certainly what I asked and definitely what we want to know. We were going to have a look at a track that you'd made as well, maybe, just as a kind of, you know, again, everyone here has their own way of working, but sometimes useful to see what someone else does. So what are we looking at? And do you want to talk us through kind of what you did?
Okay, so this is a track called Steal My Attention. This one also has a lot of examples of me pitching my vocals, and I probably should have showed this one first. I don't know why I didn't, sorry. Let's see, can you guys see it okay from your side, or is it a little too zoomed in? I can zoom it out. So here's the track. So an example of something else I like to do, start it from here. So right here, obviously we have the way that you can choose to warp tracks in Ableton. So if I want to, I can do complex proto sound. So I chose to go by beats. I can make it sound choppy. So these are just small things. I mean, it's probably not rocket science. Probably you guys probably already know how to do this kind of stuff anyways, but it's little things like this in Ableton or when I produce that I enjoy in terms of, you know, creating glitchy sort of sounds that are a bit more manual. I mean, obviously there's a lot of VSTs that exist now that can, you know, twist and rewind and do things like that. But this way I can see the audio and treat the audio and also print it like this. And I can do this effect on top of that audio. I guess here, let me show you more of the track. Song kind of keeps going on and on. I don't want to bore you guys, but I mean, you can see obviously there's some audio. I mean, I record into a lot of my tracks using synths just from an audio interface. I do like still using bits of samples, but don't call me out on it online, please. just little bits, but I think it's for integrity. Obviously, a lot of times now I don't try to sample things that I'll get in trouble for. I usually try to re-sing it, have someone else re-sing something, especially if I use pitch vocals, just because, you know. And yeah, I mean, I still use a lot of MIDI. As long as Ableton won't crash, I usually like to keep it MIDI. I mean, I can freeze tracks as well, just to sort of lower the amount of pressure it puts on my hard drive. But, you know, it's really basic. I'm not using anything too crazy. As far as a lot of VSTs I like to use, Massive is a big one. I think I layered my kicks for this. Let's see. For something like with programming bass lines, I mean, sometimes I'll choose to use like analog synths, like a Moog or something like that, like a little fatty or a sub fatty. Sometimes it's just easier for me to use a VST because I'm traveling a lot when I make tracks. And then once I get home, I'm sort of cool with it. And I don't feel the need to be super nerdy and elitist and have to re-record everything with a synth. I think you can accomplish a lot just using VSTs. An example here, one line of the bass is more for sub, and the second line is more for punch. And yeah, I mean, I don't know what else I could tell you guys, but I mean, when I program drums, another thing is I like to tap them in. One component of my music that I think is really strong is to swing the drums a little bit. And that's all according to feeling. So however you like to swing your drums, or if you like to keep your drums really quantized. I think even if you make other types of electronic music like house or techno, it still lends itself to have sort of a human element to how you program your drums. But that's just my opinion, but it's a cool way to sort of have an interesting sound signature to your music.
I think that's a pretty thorough breakdown of one track. And I guess if anyone's got any more specific questions, then you can kind of save them up and ask at the end. You just mentioned something about a human touch. I wondered if we could talk a bit about some of the humans that you work with on the record. And also, what makes a good collaboration for you?
Well, I guess on this record, I worked with three different people. It was Arama, who is an amazing singer, and another guy named Anderson Paak, and a third lovely woman named Joyce Rice. All of three who are not, you know, they're not super well known yet. You know, I think they have the potential to become great. And for me to work with someone, I don't need them to be famous. I don't care about that stuff. I care about talent and how well we work together and how much I admire them for what they are, regardless of if, you know, they're making it or if they're songwriting for big artists. None of all that stuff is meaningless to me as long as I understand the person and we get along and, you know, and they understand me too. That's really important. And as far as a lot of these collaborations with the track with Arama, I had never met her in person. The first time I met her was last week in New York. And then we made this track maybe, I don't know, 2-3 months ago. We live in a modern age where it's not important to actually meet the person in person. You know, you can build strong bonds with people. You can become someone's best friend just through the internet. And I think that's amazing. And it's great that it's not as stigmatized. Because, you know, a while ago, it was kind of weird to be like, oh, I have this friend I met online. It's kind of creepy. And
you don't really know them.
Yeah, exactly. And now, you know, I can make full songs with people I've never met in person. And she was lovely when I met her. That was great. But even just communicating via email and Dropbox and these things, she was able to, you know, we were able to work on a song that was really collaborative, you know.
You said that, you know, you want people who sound great. Like, I guess we all hear greatness in different ways, don't we? Do you know what it is about someone's vocal quality that sounds great to you?
I have no idea. I think, generally, if I hear someone's work and it resonates with me, that's all it takes. You know, I don't think I can quantify or list down qualities of this is what sounds great to me because it can change. And I've worked with so many different types of people and I don't know one characteristic that's common between all of them.
Anderson Paak is someone you mentioned and someone that you signed to you're producing as well as an artist.
Yes, yes.
And what is it about him that you like?
He's amazing. I don't even know. He's just, I've worked with so many people and they're all amazing in their own way, but he like, I don't know what it is. He's like a genius to me. I've seen him songwrite. I've written tons of songs with him already. And I can't explain what it is. I feel like he's like somehow everyone has overlooked him to a certain point. Now he's getting a lot more attention, but he's an amazing vocalist, great singer, writer. He can rap, but I think the quality maybe that that is common between all the people I like to work with is that they're soulful. They have a heart. Their music isn't cold. There's something about their quality that's very authentic and meaningful.
Can we hear something from him?
Yes.
Oops. Where did you guys meet, by the way?
We met through a mutual friend. His name was Dumbfounded, and Anderson Paak has been living in LA for quite a while, and he recently changed his name. His name before was Breezy Lovejoy, and yeah, I guess he decided to sort of, you know, rebrand or rename or start a new path. But yeah, I just think he's great.
To come to light me around this time, I only want you here.
Yeah.
It can't be heavy. I'm way too fly to let you out me, but I do care.
Oh, yeah.
It's hard to sleep.
Your body's in arm's reach, my mind is a Grand Prix. I'm liable to step out and go drive a few blocks east to rendezvous at the spot where two shy folks become beast. And for real love, baby,
no, like nothing I ever known. No, no,
for real love, baby,
that the realest, realest I ever known.
Last time before you step out and leave,
yeah.
It can't be Ivy. I'm way too fly to let you out me, but I do care. And for real love, baby.
So when will we be hearing that lovely voice again?
Soon. Mm-hmm. Not sure yet. I'm not good with dates, but, you know, we're working on stuff actively.
Okay, and any little kind of sneak tasters or ideas of what will be coming?
Not yet.
Okay, we're not going to get anything else out of her right now. Maybe later we can ask for a little listen. So I wanted to ask you about another couple of collaborations. Mm-hmm. That you've had or will be having. And the first really was with Sakamoto.
Yes.
Can you tell us what that collaboration was and how it came about?
I've collaborated with him on a couple occasions. So I'm not sure which one you're referring to. Maybe.
I was actually talking about the one where he was introduced to you by Shingo Tu.
Oh, yes. Okay.
Were they talking about Fukushima?
Yes. Okay. So I had met Ryuichi Sakamoto beforehand. He's a really amazing musician in that he's always been on the forefront of technology. Mm-hmm. He's always been about thinking forward and not backwards. So he actually discovered my music through Shingo and contacted me directly a long time ago on MySpace. if you want to gauge exactly in terms of date. So, and at first I was like, I don't know who this, like, it's, I think he had like a pseudonym or something else. And I was like, I don't know who this dude is. And then later on, Shingo Tu was like, you know, so Ryuichi Sakamoto is trying to contact you and let you know. And I was like, wow, that's really cool. So since then, you know, I've been able to speak with him. And, you know, I can say he's someone that, you know, is like almost a friend of mine, someone I look up to very dearly. And me, Shingo, and Ryuichi Sakamoto worked on a track together. They asked me to help contribute. And it was about the Fukushima nuclear power plant. And I don't speak Japanese that well, so I didn't really understand the words, but I understand how powerful it is. And, you know, they've both been on the forefront against nuclear power. You know, everyone has their own opinions on such matters, but, you know, what they're going for really meant a lot to me, and the way that they explained it to me, as well as just in general how they view our future. And he just approached me about contributing to the instrumental and to the beat. And originally it was just found sounds, and I was able to produce it out. And yeah.
Mm-hmm. So when you say you kind of, you know, you're kind of almost friends, I suppose, or friends of some kind, what kind of things would you two talk about?
I guess a lot of things. I mean, it was interesting. Once I was sitting in a cafe with him in New York, and he was asking me about the musical climate. It's different from when his career started. People bought music. Yeah. I don't know when the last time you guys bought music was, but it's been a while for me. I mean, I buy music, but it's not like how people used to, you know. And yet, this was maybe 3 years ago or something. He was asking me about that, and I was saying, yeah, you know, musicians' way of subsisting now is not like how it used to. You couldn't make a whole lot of money, or you could before survive on record sales. Now, especially as an independent artist, I think most of my income honestly comes from touring and doing all these other things. Not a significant amount comes from music. That's why, in my opinion, I almost just want people to hear the music more than to pay. Though it's cool if you guys pay, you know, I don't mind that either. But yeah, you know, that was really interesting, the generational sort of perception of music and living off music and music business, you know. I'm sure he feels that more now because he's been releasing on such cool labels like Ghostly and all these things. And yeah, I mean, that was something that I thought was very insightful in terms of him actually having a different grasp on that than I did, because I fully know what it's like to make music in this generation.
So what's the other collaboration you've done with him then?
So I have a track on my recent record, and it's, you know, I named the track after him, and I used some pieces of piano from him, and, you know, I asked him, I didn't like sample jack him, like, you can't like steal from your friend. So I asked him if it was okay, and yeah, you know, I really hope one day to grow up and be a musician like him, that's still very rooted in, you know, classical thoughts, but just so future-minded. I mean, that sounds weird to say that, but, you know, respectful of change. And a lot of people from older generations are a little resistant to change. Not everyone, but I hope that I always stay supportive of change. Good change, bad change, everything. But I can show a little bit of that track.
Please.
I don't want to bore you guys by playing like everything out, but yeah, so that was great. So I sampled those first few chords from him, or, you know, he played those first few chords, and then I was able to, so all the other pieces of piano are actually from me, so I was able to kind of take the root notes of what he, the root chords, and basically build whole songs around them. And it was, it's really fun, you know, to be able to do stuff like that and to build songs off of, like, reappropriating or appropriating songs into a new song.
Building.
Yeah, building, exactly.
I mean, you know, you play piano, properly. I'm sure, you know, obviously you use the piano as an instrument, as a kind of, you know, source for your music. But, like, if you're just sitting in front of a piano to play for yourself, or, like, what do you like to play?
I'll say this. I've taken piano for a very long time. When I was younger, I took lessons for, I don't know, 10 years. I never amounted to being much of a pianist, in my opinion. I mean, other people who have taken piano for that length of time could go on to become, like, proper pianists. But the way that I used to work with pieces when I was younger is that I would only play parts of pieces that I liked. Why did I have to play the whole song if I didn't like the whole song? So, I mean, the running joke in my family was that I couldn't play the piano, is that I couldn't play an entire piece from start to finish. And I had to explain to them that I didn't want to because I didn't like the whole song. So why did I have to play it? And now I call that classical sampling. I basically only played the parts that I like. And I think that really was an early indicator of the kind of musician I would become. I would only want to take the best parts. Who wants to play the shitty parts? No one. Well, no, people do, but, you know, that was, sorry. But, you know, a whole piano piece is beautiful, but then I was 8 and I had the attention span of a goldfish, and I didn't want to play stuff that I didn't have fun playing. And that was what was important to me with the piano. I wanted to have fun. I didn't want to be structured. I understand this. I have really poor posture, and I know piano, it's really good to have posture, and I don't know. I didn't care about any of that stuff.
So just out of interest, what are parts?
The parts I had the most fun playing, the ones that sounded the best, but also, I mean, if I think about it now, I think the pieces I liked the most were rhythmic. You know, they had a lot of staccato notes or had some element that were really fun to play. I mean, I haven't played the piano, sat down and read a piece of music for quite a while. But yeah, if I look back at it, those were the best for me.
In particular that come to mind? I mean, I know, like, with, you know, I'm asking you to cast your mind back a very long way.
Let's see. I don't know. I really can't think. I mean, I'd have to, like, Google it and find it. But, I mean, even playing something like For Elise, the reason why it's fun to play, or the reason why I like to play it, is because it was fun to play. And there was so many ways that you can sort of express yourself without being overly complicated. I have really clumsy fingers, so if I try to play like Chopin or something, I just turn it into like a jumbled little mess. And I literally haven't sat down at the piano for a while. And even then, most of the piano pieces were in a language I did not speak. And so I don't remember, but.
Okay then, so.
Sorry.
So no, don't apologize, because that's, of course, that's fine. What I wonder, though, is that musicality which you kind of had through lessons as a kid, you know, obviously it stays with you in some shape or form, and I wondered kind of what you got from knowing some of that basic stuff. How did that musicality show through in what you do now?
Basically, piano helped me learn how to build melodies. I think if I hadn't taken piano, I wouldn't know how to build, like, you know, chords in the background, like a lead melody on top, and strings and horns. And, you know, I like the orchestral quality of classical music and how things build and tell a story. That's something that I find is very prominent in my music. I always want the ending to be very grand and powerful, and I always want this, you know. A lot of classical pieces have that. They have the storyline, like it'll build and become suspenseful, or something. It'll reach its apex and then calm down and then reach its apex again. And these things, I think, are very important. That's why I don't have too many songs of mine that are just loops. You know, that's a very, you know, popular quality or common quality of a lot of, you know, beat makers, quote unquote. But I just always have to do something. It has to build in some way that is, I mean, I can build songs that are linear, but in a lot of ways I like stories that touch back to earlier parts of the song.
You like the orchestral sweep?
Yes.
And do you still use, I was quite intrigued by the fact that you use a violin, but like not necessarily in a straightforward way, that you use it to kind of make sounds.
Yes.
So how are you making sounds from the violin in your studio?
I don't know how to play the violin, and I tried once, and it's very hard. I'll just, if I can play one note on key, and then another note on key, and another note, I'll just layer them all three together and create my own sort of symphonic sound. That's a good quality about being a producer. You just sort of cut and patch and tape things together, and it sounds kind of half decent, you know? Or I can, you know, the great thing about piano or violin or any string instruments is that you can get so many strange sounds out of it as well. So just plucking it and distorting it or using the bow in a way you're not supposed to. But I find that it's just intriguing. Like real instruments are really intriguing, the ways you can use them in a non-traditional way.
I saw a cool thing actually recently where like this band were playing. They were like a sort of strange folk band, mm-hmm. and the violinist was playing, but then the percussionist was standing at the neck of the violin and kind of like playing the neck of the violin to get kind of beats out of it. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was pretty cool.
That is neat.
Apparently most violin players are pretty precious about their instruments though, so this one must have been quite cool.
Exactly. The violin I have right now is technically not mine, so... I hope my friend never sees this and knows that I've been playing. When she gets it back, it'll still look normal. Uh-huh. I'll tune it or something.
So we talked about a collaboration that you've done in the past and then spoken about this, but I wondered if we could talk about a collaboration that's coming up, one with Kelly Rowland.
Yes. So I have a project coming out with Kelly Rowland, also from Destiny's Child. Also... sounds really random, right? But I guess me being so, I don't like using the term underground, but I'm so below the surface in a lot of ways. And even though I think I've grown over the years, I still consider myself kind of not an above the surface kind of artist. And the way I perceive these big pop acts is that they don't know about us. They don't listen to music. They only listen to what they make or what the studio tells them to listen to. And just so many misconceptions. And that's not true. She loves music. She loves all sorts of music. She loves my music. And I was like, wow, that is really unexpected. And music from my peers and music that even I don't know about, you know. And
Like who?
Well, she was working on a track with Giorgio Moroder. That's not an example of someone I don't know, but then that was still an example of someone I was very surprised by. I was like, oh, really? That's kind of tight, you know? But I think that her taste in music is more sophisticated than I would have thought because there's only so much that we know. We think we know so much about these people via TMZ or like Us Magazine or whatever your national equivalent to trashy magazines are, you know? But I still respect her. Everyone, I mean, I grew up listening to Destiny's Child. They're like awesome. It's like the thing. I mean, they're just all super talented. And she's someone I always thought was like, you know, she was a favorite. Everyone likes Beyonce. I like Kelly Rowland. It's just one of those things. And, so yeah, we started working on some tracks together and I mean, it was just amazing for her to listen to my stuff and be like, I want us to make a track to this one beat. And it's one of my most like esoteric, strange beats. I'm like, how do you want to do this? And we'll make it happen. But
so how do you, when you're working with Kelly, mm-hmm. like where does that happen?
In the studio. It's kind of interesting. So I am only used to producing at home. I can't produce in big studios. I can tweak mixes. I can cut vocals, those type of things. But I kind of have to work from home and, so I'll usually bring a lot of beats in advance. So I'll, you know, have 10 tracks and be like, you know, if any of these speak to you, let me know. We can start writing to these songs. And, she'll go through and listen. And of course I'll make edits to the beats. They're all open, you know, when I anticipate vocals on tracks, I'll leave them a little bare, which is a little difficult for me because I'm used to making tracks with just so much stuff in them. But, yeah, I'll just have all these songs. And a lot of these tracks I made just for this project. Mm-hmm. I didn't change anything for her, but I just made new tracks, mm-hmm. you know. And that's the biggest thing, too, is I didn't want to sacrifice my artistic integrity just because I was working with some big pop star or something like that, you know, and she was respectful of that too. She worked with me because she knows what kind of music I make, and yeah.
Yeah, she wouldn't want you to come with something different because she what she wants is what you got.
You never know. I could be the next. Oh, I don't want to say anything. I mean, you know.
But it's interesting because that ability to kind of like totally be in the realm that you're in, but also be very comfortable working on a bigger level, also applies to your live kind of setup as well.
Mm-hmm.
And I wondered if you could tell us like how differently you might approach like a kind of a club show to something where you're in on a kind of much bigger stage with much bigger
names. I try not to really change my set too much. I figure that if I'm on some kind of bill, people are there to see me and all I have to offer. Though if I am playing like a big festival stage, for example, at, or if I'm playing, let's say, like a quote unquote EDM stage, these things are very conflicting towards me because I'm like, I don't know how I can do this. But it's weird how that whole realm has shifted and become wider. What was once, I mean, I don't like that phrase. I definitely don't think I qualify that even from like a press perspective, but it's sort of widened, and now the stuff that I make usually can still, you know, make people excited on a stage where I'm playing next to someone like Skrillex or Diplo or whatever. And that's been fortunate. But yeah, when I play my own club shows, I'm definitely gonna play stuff I think is going to cater to those people that came to this small intimate show just to see me.
I mean, do you have to prepare differently for one of those shows? Do you bring different kit with you?
Not really. I mean, when I play, I use Ableton, and I always have a skeleton. So these tracks I know I'm always going to play, usually stuff of my own. And I sort of fill in the meat in between on the fly. So the meat changes when I play, you know, a larger show. I'll play certain other songs versus, you know, other songs I'll play for a club show. But, you know, I try to make the bulk of my set consistent through both, because, you know, I don't want to be wishy-washy. I just might feel like a daytime set versus a nighttime set, you might play something different.
So if you were to cast your mind back to your very first shows, can you remember actually the first show you did?
Yes, it was really bad. Where was it? I was so nervous. I think it was, okay, there's two. I don't know which one was first, but I remember playing in a weird small venue, and I had to set up all my gear on top of turntables and play kind of like this wonky set where I was like playing on the side. And then I didn't really know how to use my controller, that because I bought a controller just to use with live, and I was so used to just being a producer that I didn't know what I was doing. And a couple songs would stop, and then I was like, oh crap, the song stopped. No one really cared. It was okay. I think people were fairly forgiving or whatever. But at that time, I mean, things like that happen now too. But when something stops, I know how to play it off. Like, oh yeah, I did that on purpose. Back then, when something stopped, it was more like, oh shit, what did I do? And everyone knows that I really messed up. And it'd be like, oh no, crap. But yeah, I mean, I learned from it. And I appreciate all those moments. It's definitely also taught me to be more resilient and tougher, because things happen when you play live and things happen when you perform, and even now shows can be not what I expect, and I just now I don't care, I just smile and be like, eh, whatever.
So where did you kind of learn your performance chops, like in LA, in kind of the local clubs?
Yeah, I mean, probably playing at places like Low in Theory, which is a club in Los Angeles. Yeah, just playing, having the opportunity to play there. And it's a skill that's developed over time, and I'm still perfecting it. I think live performing is very different to me than producing, but that's why I use Ableton, because it's kind of easier for me to produce that, or to perform live, because it's more similar to producing. Mm-hmm. I wasn't an artist that started off DJing and decided to become a producer. I started off producing and learned how to DJ and perform after. So,
and what kind of things have you finessed about how you perform over the years between those kind of like early nervous kind of panic gigs and what you're doing now?
Well, I mostly learned to take the pressure off myself. I think before I used to make myself so nervous before I performed that I just couldn't concentrate on what I should be doing. The more relaxed I am, the better I am at, mm-hmm. you know, finessing through my set, but also learning to be more active. If it's just me in front of a computer and a controller, that's pretty boring. There's not much to do. I mean, I will be honest, it's not that exciting, but I think there's a charisma that's necessary to perform live, and I'm a very awkward person, if you haven't realized that right now. And I think just to be able to be more free on stage, I mean, it's not being theatrical. I was never very theatrical. I wasn't like a drama kid who like took Shakespeare. I was too nervous to do that kind of stuff. And now I've learned to become on stage and just disregard the crowd and just enjoy myself. On like, that sounds weird, sorry. Enjoy the act of just playing music for myself, you know, and if everyone in the audience is happy, they're happy with me. And if they're not, at least I'm still having fun. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I guess moving it away from live a little bit and talking a bit about the kind of way you release your music. I thought it was interesting that with one of the tracks from Desiderium, you just kind of like, just kind of put it out without telling anybody, and you, I think like the Twitter message was like, oh, everyone's going to be annoyed about this, but it's my music and I don't care. It's just like, mm-hmm. I'm going to put something out. How important is it for you to be in control of the timing of your releases?
I think it's fairly important. I've come to this point now where, you know, traditionally, when you release an album with a label, they need lead-in time. So that means time for them to get the proper press, to make sure they have distributors, and to get your billboard up, or make sure they just all this, these like these things that they think are really important. But in my mind, the most important thing is the music. And in the age that we live in now, I mean, when's the next time you guys are gonna pick up a magazine and judge an album on the magazine? Like buy the album because the magazine said it was good. I'm pretty sure you guys will all go, maybe you'll see the article, but you guys will go online and listen to it and then decide for yourself if you guys like it. And for me, I think that getting the music out there is more important. Also, as a musician, by the time by the time my album comes out, I'm already past it. I'm already like, I'm not really like that proud of it now, because I'm doing this new stuff, and I think this new stuff is way better than the old stuff. Not to say I don't appreciate my old work, but with me being able to control how I release my music, I can put it out as soon as I think it should come out. Like, it's relevant now. I want it to come out now. I don't want my music to come out in 6 months from now when I don't think it's relevant anymore. Because by 6 months from now, all the things I did that I thought were really cutting edge or really interesting won't be important. It won't be the same way. It won't have that impact. I'm also very impatient. And I think that, I don't know, I just hate that idea where I put out an album and the songs I'm making at the time when the album releases, I think is more advanced than the album itself. And I have to go and live with this old piece of work that I did. So, yeah.
So how kind of fully indie or not are you now?
I think I'm like more indie than I've ever been since I released my own record, and I've never actually done that before. But at the same time, my reach is the furthest it's ever been. So I don't really, these labels are kind of silly now, saying you're indie or underground or mainstream or pop, because now you have, because pop used to describe a sound, but pop also means popular, but now you have indie artists that are paving their way in super pop music, but it's still indie. And then what's indie if it's not underground? But it's on a label, but indie labels are now also bigger than they were before. It's contrived and annoying and weird. So I'm just like, I'm just a musician that makes music in the middle ground. I don't know.
So is this something that you think you'll be doing more of? Just kind of, you know, releasing stuff yourself and through, it's Young Art, isn't it? Your new label. So is that the kind of route for you for the next little while?
Not necessarily, actually. You know, I created the label as a platform for artists that I believe in. And I want to be really active on my label. You know, I don't want to have my label, but then myself release on other labels. I think that I want to pave the way for my artists that I choose. And it's not a money-making venture at all. I just really want people to hear music and music that I believe in and hopefully other people believe in as well. But, you know, if I feel like I want to release a new EP on Brainfeeder, I can just hit up Flying Lotus and be like, do you want to release this? And he'll be like, yeah, cool, whatever. And then I'll release it. I think a lot of this label stuff is just about, you know, if I make an album for Brainfeeder again, it's going to have a sound that I think fits them well. And or if I do it on another label, I mean, I don't, it's all weird and stuff, but yeah, it's released on whoever I want to, as long as I have creative control.
Mm-hmm. So I guess in the time that we've got now, we're not, stuff we're not going to be able to talk about, and you guys can ask questions when you want, when it's time, I guess. whenever you want, jump in. But I did want to ask you about, because you had a kind of brief period working for a video game.
Yes.
What were you doing with them?
So when I was working at the video game company, I was working in like production and business development. Mm-hmm. So I just sat in the office and helped all the producers of the video games with stuff. I was more active on that side than with the licensing side. But, you know, I got to sit down and play video games for fun. That wasn't actually a part of my job. It's just something I was able to do. But yeah, you know, it's got to see how video games are made from a producer side, not a developer side. And that was pretty cool. It's also really stressful to be a video game producer. That's what I've also learned.
So were you involved in kind of the music at all for, was it Mortal Kombat?
I wasn't actually that involved in the music side, though I had an appreciation, and everyone who worked in the office on that side was such a big fan of music. I mean, I even had a coworker from my former company play guitar on my EP for Brainfeeder. So we all just had this really deep love for music. We'd use like our company file sharing thing to like drop music into each other's folders. And, you know, they would tell me all about like the guy who did all the music for Final Fantasy, and just how he was just a guy that worked at the company. He ended up scoring all of the video games. You know, it's pretty neat.
I guess actually something else that would be nice to ask you about then is the kind of anime composers or music for anime. Mm-hmm. You know, it feels like the people that make the music for video games are kind of getting the recognition that they deserved now to mm-hmm. some extent. But I wondered kind of how the kind of anime music, whether or not anime music had kind of influenced what you did, or if you had any thoughts about those particular favorites maybe.
It's interesting, the idea of anime culture, anime music, because now it's so much more mainstream than it was when I was growing up. Anime was kind of, well, because I'm Asian American, it's kind of more instilled. It's very normal to watch anime, you know, growing up, it's just on TV. But then from a Western perspective, it was always like this otaku, like different, like all the anime kids were like their own thing. They'd go to anime expo, and yet now everyone enjoys anime. You don't have to be this, like a kid that dresses up in cosplay. Like people have an appreciation for watching, I don't know, like whatever it might be that you're into, there's just so many great ones, as well as like anime as a film genre, which is different than it as a cartoon. But now I see producers that are adopting anime music as a style, like a stylistic quality that they really enjoy. Like Anna Managuchi, like these people that take 8-bit sounds from video games and anime, but you know, obviously they're composing completely original music with that element involved, and it's cool. I love it. I'm a big nerd, so I think it's amazing to hear this kind of music become more mainstream, the sort of kawaii nature of video game and cartoon, like anime music as well. But then it also crosses over the other side, because with someone like Shingo Too, who worked with New Jabez, they brought hip-hop into Samurai Champloo, which was a very prominent anime here in Japan. So I mean, it kind of goes both ways. Like, you know, anime music is kind of delving outside of being super sparkly and bubbly, and then you have the outside music becoming more of that. And people like Kyari Pamyu, who's like crazy from an art perspective but very J-pop at the same time, it's really cool how music is becoming more global without intending to be. It's just becoming that way.
Yeah. Just, I guess, just by the nature of things.
Yes.
It's happening.
Is that internet? I don't know.
That internet.
Yeah.
Okay, so I guess one final thing before we open up to you guys. Is there anything that you've got kind of coming up that you could tell us about, or maybe some music that you could play us, some stuff that's nearly with us?
I guess the only thing that I'm working on right now that's coming up soon is a project for Gavin Turek, and she's a wonderful singer who's worked on my, who had a couple tracks on my Creature Dreams EP on Brainfeeder, and so I will be releasing her on Young Art as well. And I do have a track, but it's not mixed, and it's with her on it, but we'll see. Hopefully you guys don't mind that it sounds a little rough. Yeah, that's really rough, but I think you guys get the idea.
Most definitely. So, questions from the floor with some microphones. First question.
Hello.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, good. Thank you so much for this talk. I wanted to hear, like, one of the first tracks you played of your own, there was these, like, very floating pads in the background.
Mm-hmm.
I just wanted to know if you could say a bit about how, like, you got to that sound, like, what reverb were you using?
Ah, yes. That one's a good one. It's, like, the basic, most default sound on Absinthe. So I didn't really have to do anything. I mean, I do like using reverb with a very long decay. And, well, I guess a long decay, but not too long. Make sure you EQ out, like, the bottom, like, the low end of the EQ and the high end. Also, panning is really important. But it doesn't take that long to find a sound that you like. It's just about finding it, right? You can get the same sound on a Nord if you want to. I just found it on Absinthe. Literally, when you open the VST, that's the sound that pops out. I always think it's really silly when people overcomplicate patches. Another great thing, though, is to press mutate. So if you don't want to just go for the regular default sounds that they have, Absinthe has a great mutate button that'll just, like, mutate the sound until it turns into some weird, crazy thing sometimes it'll just end up mutating into nothing, but it's a cool feature to use.
How, like, were you singing that yourself?
Singing in that track?
Yeah, like the pad. It sounds like it's a vocal sample.
Oh, wait. Are you talking about the very first track I made? Or I showed you guys? Or
it's like a really floating, like, in the background. It has, like, this very, like, behind some, like, more upfront vocal stuff.
Did it have the percussion in it? Is that the one that had, like, the East Asian percussion thing?
Maybe.
Here, wait. I'll be able to explain it better if I know what song you're talking about. Was it this one? Was it that one?
No,
okay. So then disregard everything I just said because it wasn't relevant to the song that I thought you were talking about. Were you talking about the one where I was singing?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, this one? Is it that one?
Yes.
Okay, there we go. So yeah, the background of that is vocals. Just vocals with a long decay, just harmonized on top of each other. It's always good to double vocal, double or triple vocals, even the harmonies too. It makes for a very thick sound, and especially if you're gonna use it texturally like that in the background. Because you're referring to like the howling sort of sound, right? Yeah.
Reverb
were
you using?
That one, I was either using the Mac, it's like a max patch. They have a reverb that comes in there. They're like the pack that comes with it, or it's a convolution reverb, or it's just the Ableton reverb, in which everyone, if you guys use that, make sure you set the quality to high, because everyone always leaves it on eco and it sounds like crap. So yeah.
Okay, where's the microphone going? To the front.
I was just wondering when you work with vocals, do you write with them?
Yes and no. It depends. Some of them I'll write with. Like the track I just showed with Gavin, I sat down and helped her write it.
The last one.
Yeah, the one I just... The last one I played before we went into questions. So, but I don't like stepping on a vocalist's toes, you know. One quality I really admire from vocalists is their ability to write. But sometimes, you know, I have a track on my new album where I wrote the entire thing and someone else sang it. Because mm-hmm. that's fun for me to be able to sort of sing vicariously through someone else who can sing, because I can't sing. But yeah, sometimes when I'm with singers, I'll just help them maybe format the song or help build harmonies with them. But, you know, I don't try to tell them, like, how to write a poem. You know, I'll let them do their thing.
Mm-hmm. Not even as much for the lyrics, but the vocal melodies?
Vocal melodies, it kind of depends on the person. Some people are really touchy, so I just know not to. Other ones, you know, I'll bring in a suggestion and be like, oh, it's starting to sound repetitive. What about if we change the melody at the end, at the turnaround, so it's the influx is higher, or you know the note goes up at the end or down? It's very varying levels, because some people I will contribute a lot. Like most of the song is written by me, and they just say like maybe we should do something here or there. Sometimes they write the majority, and then I'll chime in every now and then. Sometimes it's very 50-50. So it's I like that process though, just knowing how much to work on something with someone and how much you want them to shine and let them do their own thing.
Also, just one other question. With the Kelly Rowland track, mm-hmm. were you all thinking about her kind of image when you were making the song? Because it reminded me of Motivation, how it's like super sexy, and I think that's something she does a lot. Were you thinking about that, or did it just happen?
We weren't really thinking about that. I think... Anderson wanted to write about that. I think as a guy, he was explaining to me that he likes to write about things that he thinks about a lot. And so I guess as a guy, he just thinks about sex a lot. I don't know.
So he wasn't even writing it from her perspective.
I mean, he had to write it a little bit from her perspective because he's a dude and he doesn't want to write it like he's a guy because then it just won't make sense from a girl. Uh-huh. But I encouraged, in the writing process for her, I really encouraged making the song sound less specific, because I want it to sound like it's from her, but I want it to sound like it applies to anyone, you know? So,
totally.
Yeah. So, I mean, that track is one that we wrote to, and it's also one that she liked, because we wrote a bunch of tracks, and she really liked it.
It totally makes sense for her.
Yeah, she's really into, like, sexy stuff.
Yeah.
And you were talking about the technology allows you to work like with people that are from other places mm-hmm. and stuff. Can you tell us, like, I know it can be like Skype or anything, but mm-hmm. what, how's like the dynamics of working with some people? Because I don't know if it's like a long call, like 3 hours talking and mm-hmm. sharing like the monitor or something like that. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us about like the process of working with someone mm-hmm. in the internet?
It kind of depends. With the track with Arama, I sent her an instrumental, and I just wanted to be like, you. Why don't you just do whatever you want on it? I'm not going to give you direction, because I wanted to feature her, and by featuring her, I wanted her to make a song she was happy with, not a song where I'm like, why don't you make it sound like this song combined, and try not to sing like yourself, because I don't like how you sound. Yeah, I don't, you know, collaborate with people for those reasons, so... I sent her the track first, and she recorded some vocals and then sent them back to me. And I'm like, oh, yeah, these are cool. Maybe we should try doing this or that. Or I think this part should be the hook, and then we should move the verse around. So it was actually really simple with her, because she sent me a track that I was almost 100% on, and I asked her to make some changes, and then it came back 100%. With production, it's a little different in that... you know, I'll just do a collect all and save to Dropbox. So me and the other person will be able to collaborate on the production together. And we can just chat about it online and be like, oh, I'm going to go in and change this. That's okay with you. Or maybe I'll write a synth line and the other person's like, I think I want to change the sound. So they'll keep mine just in case we want to stick with that idea and write something on top and we'll edit. But I think at some point it's helpful to sit down with someone to work on stuff. But yeah, I don't know, with vocalists, I'm really good at just letting them express themselves as they like, you know.
Okay.
Hi. Sorry, I got another technical question for you here.
Sure.
I noticed in your productions, a lot of times they've got a really earthy sort of organic feel to them. Mm-hmm. I know you already elaborated a bit on swing and humanization that way, but specifically, like, for example, in your 2-1 remix, when the bass first comes in, mm-hmm. It's got the really nice earthy feel. I'm just wondering if you can elaborate a bit on how you achieve that.
The bass line is in the sound or the rhythm?
Definitely, like, from the sound design.
Okay. I struggled with that so much, because the bass line was so aggressive, and I had to use, on the master, I really had to control the bass with like a multi-band compression. I think I used the waves one, but it's just, I was trying to, that song, everything is so like overdriven. Like the drums are super loud, the bass is really loud, and I had to do a lot of EQing and compressing and stuff to make sure that it would come through in the mix without just hiding everything else. As far as the sound itself, I'm not sure which one did I use. I think I used a microkorg on that. And then from there, I recorded the microkorg into Ableton. I used multi-band compression within there, the one that's an Ableton one. And then I might have used, like, I don't think I used any low-pass filters, but using their, shit. I wish I had the session. I would just show you, but it's on a different computer. But yeah, I mean, as far as getting that earthy sound, a lot of it is just like making things super thick. Because the reality is, like, if you want to program drums that sound like the MPC, it's not that, you can't make it sound perfect, but there are ways to manipulate the drums to sound like that. Especially depends on the samples you're using. And if it comes from an organic source, like I recorded a synth for that, a bass synth from an actual synth, then it'll be easier to get that earthy sound. But I don't think it's necessary.
Thank you. To get that thickness with the bass, do you utilize reverb or reverb at all?
No, there's no reverb on that one. Okay. Actually, with bass sounds, I try not to use reverb because the way it affects the rest of the mix.
Yeah.
Unless you want to EQ, like if you do a send reverb and then you decide to EQ the reverb on the send channel, that helps a lot too. But I mean, I might do that sometimes. If I have a bass, and I always keep my, it's sort of a traditional way to just keep the bass in the center. If I have another bass line, but it's more for texture, like I'll EQ out all the low end and just have the highs of the sum. Like, let's say it's a buzzy synth or a buzzy bass synth. I'll EQ out the bottom. I might stereo pan the higher frequencies while keeping the sub still in the center. And that's a really cool effect. And sometimes do that on kick drums too.
So like sub and mono and then stereo.
Yeah. But it depends too, because you know, if you're going to plan to play some of this stuff out at the club, most club speakers are summed. So then if you're going to have phasing, it might be a problem. But there's always, you know, there's good VSTs to avoid that too.
Thank you so much.
No problem.
Any more questions? Are we going to go for the informal ones afterwards? In which case, I think we should all say a very big thank you to TOKiMONSTA. Thank you.
Thank you, guys.